times I, when I asked patients that how they felt, they said that since they were the ones that decided to move to America, that they are the ones that should know English. And it was never backwards. They never said, oh, the doctor should know Spanish, the staff should be able to communicate with me in Spanish. That was never something that was expressed. So I think the fact that they blame themselves so much is also a reason why a lot of them like don't seek care as much as they should, because they feel like they can't communicate in the same way.
Or in certain cases, they'll delay seeking care until the point where things have gotten really bad. And in collaborating with Mary on that project, we did see a lot where the patients would say, well, you know, we have to be grateful for whatever attention they're giving you, and you gotta take whatever they give you. And so I'm not gonna necessarily request the specific service if their attention is really important to me. So it's almost like they don't see themselves as deserving of a certain type of service, which they'll take whatever service you're gonna give them. So I think it highlights some of the power dynamics that come across in the patient encounter. It definitely worth knowing, especially educating physicians on, because this could lead to a lot of times the patient's not like, fully expressing what's going on or communicating that.
Yeah, and Sichi touches on something really important. There's a medical piece to that too. Every patient comes to the ER, tries something else at home, okay? And every patient can be ER delayed by either hours, days, weeks, however long, okay? What I try to do with this is take this and say, how can we make this not one of those reasons, right? Right now, it's definitely one of those reasons. The patient doesn't know if the doctor's gonna speak English. They don't know if they're gonna have a translator available, what kind of translator they're gonna have. They're gonna ask their 7-year-old kid to translate about a gynecological exam. How many times a day that happens in our ER? Okay, and so all these things, we can remove those barriers so easily right now. And we have a free video phone service that is on your phone you walk around with. Google Translator is amazing. You're on my watch, it'll translate the patient while I talk to them. Like, these don't cost me anything. And so if I take the barriers away from my providers to utilize them, and then make sure the patient understands we're gonna do the same way every time, that's hopefully no longer even a reason not to come.
There's another issue also. The catchment area for the hospital includes agricultural areas to the south and to the east of the city. Some of the Spanish-speaking patients are migrant workers who may or may not be documented, and these people are increasingly afraid of any kind of institutional encounter and literally, you know, express this attitude, you know, I'm grateful for anything I get, whatever that is, in whatever language. And they are increasingly afraid to, you know, request the kinds of services that should be provided for them.
Which we never asked that question, if anybody's curious, that's not a question.
Right, the ER is interesting. We do not ask about documentation status. Initially, when you come into the ER, there's no discussion of insurance. Either by federal law or emergency rooms are required to treat everyone regardless of insurance status, and it's only at the end when there's negotiation about how are we going to deal with this big bill. And the bill is always large. My son broke his hand, and they had trouble understanding that he was fully covered by Blue Cross Blue Shield, and he came home initially with a $3,000 bill. It got whittled down to $100, which I thought was quite reasonable, all things included, especially since he did it for a stupid reason. But nevertheless, you can imagine the person who did not have insurance who, you know, ends up with a $3,000 bill. But those are whole other issues about healthcare in America. Other questions or comments? Yes?
In regards to sort of like steps forward reducing stigma in the ED and whatever capacity deductibles, you hit on 2 points towards the end of your closing comments about how your perception sort of in training for a physician about what your experience in the emergency room is gonna be like and the types of conditions that you'll be treating is much different than the reality of the situation, in addition to which a lot of these types of stigma seem to be embedded culturally. So also keeping in mind Dr. Baer's sort of, it's not just about identifying the problem, what are you gonna do about it,
is a more emergency medicine education way. I'll start with the broader one. So about 4 or 5 years ago, the Medical College Admission Test, the MCAT, underwent a pretty substantial change, the first big substantial change in about 30 years. And there was an inclusion for an attempt to change the applicant pool to make people who, I think Rob uses a good term, we try to select students for our course who are primed for this. They can at least seem to be individuals who look like they're gonna be willing to learn a patient-centric approach.
They chose to take an anthropology course even before they knew that that would get them into
even
our class.
Even though the doctor was sitting there, like, you know, bringing them to the ER. But, because then they'll all sign up. But, you know, so we, I think that the goal of the MCAT change was to at least get an applicant pool that looked a little bit more like people who might be empathetic or have a little higher emotional intelligence. I don't know if that's a successful attempt or not, but that was the goal. And again, I would take that goal back to an understanding that patient experience and revenue are tied together and they can't keep on doing the same thing. So I think the way I approach that goal is essentially by saying, not only do you have to select the applicant pool, but you also have to do something in the curriculum. Right now, if you look at medical school curriculum, there are a few places that deal with culture. And usually how culture is dealt with in medical training is by competency, not by really truly understanding culture. And it's really about the competency to get the person to do the biomedical thing you want them to do, or to get them to understand the biomedical thing you're trying to explain. So, oh, I get it, you need a male to do the public exam, fine, we'll get a male. Oh, you speak a different language, fine, we'll use the blue phone, okay. But understanding how those things touch the healthcare experience differently, or explaining variation in a different way, like explaining variation about sickle cell users or opioid abusers, those kind of things, that's not touched at all. And that's, I'd say, at best, a one-day sort of seminar kind of thing in medical school. What you often always get too is your approach to this is a humanities type of approach where you learn some medical history, you see some art about medicine, and that's really it. That's your cultural approach. So I don't think we can expect there to be a patient-centric change when you select an applicant pool but you don't give them any tools, right? Oh good, we got better applicants, but we stopped training them. We gave them a history art class. So I think what we've tried to do is create a very early impactful experience that they some learner they'll never forget, and that we hope will shape their, and we're actually looking at this formally, we're following these guys who get into medical school, we follow them through their medical training to see if there's sustainability of this patient-centric approach we've given them that lasts throughout their medical training and hopefully makes them approach, you know, not like me, but kind of more like this, you know, where we recognize we have to get at these issues. That's broad. Emergency medicine, at the end of the day, is really just going to have to change the way we train our residents. There's just no way around it. If you look at the, and this is a different kind of question, but we're asked to do more and more in the emergency department. Our role as a safety net has increased more and more. Our need to be there for emergencies is important, but what we do most of the time is not emergent, but we are always busy. So what you have are a bunch of doctors who are pissed off, they're always busy doing the thing they didn't think they were gonna do. So it's not too hard to reconceptualize that and say, there's a lot of stuff to do, why don't we train you to do all this stuff and let you know what you're signing up for before you come in the door. And so I run a big HIV program. That's not a thing that a lot of ER doctors thought we'd be doing in our ER. We do a lot of HIV in our ER. I care about opioid abuse because it's a hepatitis C problem. You don't have hepatitis C yet, you're shooting up IV drugs, you're gonna get it within 3 years by sharing needles. And if you have hepatitis C and you want me to help you get on drugs to treat your hepatitis C, you're gonna have to get clean off opioids first because otherwise you're gonna reacquire hepatitis C and get resistance. So understanding things like hepatitis C, understanding opioid abuse, understanding how to deal with drug treatment programs, and a lot of mental health, right? These are things we're gonna have to decide, we're gonna put into the emergency medicine curriculum at some point. So on my other hat, right, my other academic world, that's what I work on trying to change, is what we do with emergency medicine training. And SAEM, which is Society for Academic Emergency Medicine, is attuned to this and listening to this, but at the same time, we also went from a 4-year training to a 3-year training. So we get 36 months to train our residents to deal with heart attacks, strokes, and traumas, but also need to be able to deal with all these other kind of people who come in the door too. Otherwise, you will burn out in emergency medicine and we'll lose those providers.
What we are trying to do in the course course, and now we have a two-course sequence for undergraduates, our initial explicit goal was to build better doctors. We wanted to create something in the training program for physicians that would be very different from the kinds of experiences that we saw in other kinds of spaces. We required a second goal because some of our students decide they don't want to be physicians, they go on in anthropology, and we would, and I'll